Reloading post-pandemic, this week on Mail Call Mondays. Mail Call Mondays is brought to you by MDT. If you need a chassis system for your precision rifle, check out mdttac.com. I'm John McQuaid with 8541 Tactical, and this is Mail Call Mondays, the show that answers your questions about precision rifles, optics, and equipment. Welcome to another Mail Call Mondays, and this Monday we are going to talk about reloading. We haven't done it in a little while, so I'm going to talk about specifically some issues with reloading now that we have a pretty good scarcity of components, and talk about some best practices as you go through and use whatever you can find. Usually, when we reload, we have a specific recipe that we like to stick with. Most of us have gone through a pretty intensive load workup to find exactly what the rifle likes or what we prefer to use to get the most accurate loads out of a rifle. But nowadays, you may not be able to find the components that you actually originally worked up for that gun. So what do you do when you go to the gun shop or your buddy is trying to offload some powder or some primers and you end up with stuff that you wouldn't normally use? So reloading, there are a lot of fine points to reloading and a lot of rules to go through reloading. And as long as we start low and work up, we're generally okay and we can notice pressure signs and things before stuff gets out of hand. And we've done a whole reloading series on this, which I will link to above so you guys can check that out. And we go into detail about picking loads and how to put the load together, how to actually reload a case from end all the way to finished product. I'm sorry, from beginning to finished product. So we won't rehash all that. But what I want to talk about here is, for instance, the load I have sitting here in front of me, or the box of empty cases I have sitting in front of me, is for my 300 Win Mag, which I have not shot a lot. I don't shoot it a lot, so I don't keep a lot of components on hand for it. Well, I wanted to load it up and do some work with it here lately because I'm going to be making some changes to that system. And I suddenly realized I don't really have all the components that I need to put the load that I worked up in that rifle back together. So this load originally used 208 ELDM bullet, so Hornady bullet, 30 caliber, of course, because it's a 300 Win Mag. We are running Black Hills brass because the original loads that I shot through that rifle were Black Hills, and I still have brass remaining from those. And it's perfectly good brass, so no reason to get rid of it. And I was using H1000 in these, and of course I was using Magnum primers in it. I believe I was originally using Winchester. I didn't write the primer down on the inside of the cover of the box here, but it's in my load book. So I don't have all of those components to load these. So we run into some situations where we might be tempted to shortcut some of the steps. Now, when we talk about switching components in a load recipe that you've already worked up, we have to be very, very careful about what we're doing. It can be very easy to exceed the pressure that the rifle can comfortably shoot, and you can have all kinds of issues, pierced primers, case head separations, or you could have a complete detonation in the rifle and cause you all kinds of problems. So we don't want to just swap components willy-nilly. But there are some things that we can shortcut just a little bit and not have to do a full load workup on. And there are some things that we are just going to have to bite the bullet and go do a full load workup on. So let's talk about the first part, the most important part. Let's talk about bullets. So this is worked up for the 208 ELDM. Let's say instead that I got a great deal on some 200 grain burgers or something like that. I know that's probably not within the realm of likelihood, but let's just say I did. Or another 200 class 30 caliber bullet that I haven't worked with before in this rifle. Now, if I've used it before, it's easy. I just go back and look in my low workup notes and see what charges were safe in that gun, and then I can go ahead and run forward with that. I don't have to work up anything. I can just look back at my notes and roll. But if I don't have any data on this bullet, then I've got one of two choices. Now, the absolutely safest method would be to totally do the new load workup, and that would give me the most accurate results, find out what the most accurate powder charge is with that bullet. However, if I'm using a really high-end bullet like a Berger, it's probably going to shoot pretty well across the board. So if I want to shortcut it and I don't want to waste the powder on a full load workup, then I can roll the dice. I can drop down about 10%. And this is assuming that you're not greatly exceeding the top end on the charges that you currently have worked up, which these are not super hot charges. So I could drop down 10% using the same brass, the same powder, the same primer, and then load a case at each, say, half grain increment up there, getting back to where I was, and shoot that chain of rounds. And notice if I don't get any pressure signs along the way, I'm probably going to be pretty good with that. And then I should be able to notice there if I get any extreme flyers. If they are grouping fairly well together, and if you want to go through and you want to mark the velocities and where they're at and plot that, then you can do kind of a mini workup. Although I generally like to go low to high and then at least back to low for at least one run. That way we see how each of those loads is performing in a hot barrel as well as in a cool barrel. But that will be a safer method than just throwing that bullet on top of your normal charge weight and rolling with it. Because the difference in the geometry of the bullet second or tangent ogive is going to make a difference on the pressure curve in that case. So you don't want to change the bullet and how it engraves in the rifling causes a huge pressure spike. So we don't want to just swap that around. Same thing with primers. If we change primers, we're running one brand primer to another brand primer. I noticed that primers have a much, much smaller effect on pressures and on what I'm seeing downrange or what I'm seeing across the chronograph. They do have a little bit of effect, and if you get some cheap primers, you may have some issues. But again, we're doing what we can do to keep shooting. So primers, if you change up primers, again, the best safe practice would be to drop back 10%. And with primers, I might even run a little bit wider jump between each of the different steps in it. But again, drop down 10%, work back up. That's going to be the safest way to go on primers because that way, even if you're okay with general pressure inside the case, you can watch the primer and see if you're getting any deformation or cratering in the primer cup, because you don't want to pierce primers. If you start piercing primers, you can gas cut your firing pin, and then it's a problem that just continues. It will do all kinds of damage to the firing pin and the bolt face if you keep punching holes in your primers. So we've covered bullets and primers. Now, how about cases? Cases are kind of interesting because this is one where we can measure the case and get a little bit of an estimate on how it's going to affect what our pressure is inside the case. So if you are using a case that has the same internal volume, and the way that I like to measure the internal volume on the case is you set it on your scale, you zero it out. Now you have to make sure it's a clean case, that there's nothing remaining inside the case. Set it on the scale, zero it out, make sure that there is a spent primer still in it, or you're going to have to put something in the tail end of the case to plug the flash hole in it. And then with a dropper, start filling it with water. And you'll fill it with water all the way up to the case mouth. And because of the surface tension of the water, you will start to get a dome when you fill the mouth of the case. So watch that, and you'll want to get a consistent dome on it. you can come very, very close to flat across the case, but I'll do it until it just starts to dome over the top of the case. Obviously, you don't want water running down the side because then you've totally screwed up your test. You're going to have to dump everything out. Don't even use the same case. Start with a different case because there may be water remaining inside of it. So you get that dome, see what your weight is, write that weight down. Do that for about 10 cases or so. And then take your average of your case capacity on your cases that you're already using that you've done your load workup on. Then take your new cases and run the same process on the new cases. And that will give you an idea of what the difference is in the capacity between them. If they're fairly close, it's really not going to have an effect on the pressure on your load. Now, neck thickness, neck diameter, that can have a little bit of an effect, but the actual capacity of the case should have very little effect between two cases with the same case capacity. I've got a couple of different 308 loads through here that I can effectively use the same load on the different cases because they are almost the same case capacity. If we're going to from a tighter case capacity to a larger case capacity, generally you can do that just fine as well, and you may get a little bit of a drop off in velocity. It's going to be very dependent upon a bunch of other factors, but you shouldn't get a pressure spike that will cause you problems. Again, best practice is drop down 10% and work up. That's going to be your safest bet. But again, you can use pretty large increments when you're doing your steps to work up so that you don't end up running into issues or wasting a ton of extra components going through this. And a lot of this is just conserving components. I normally would not do this if I was flush with components. I would go ahead and do a full workup again to see how the whole system, all the components together, are affecting the accuracy out of the rifle. But these are trying times, so we're trying to do whatever we can to save components. Now, the one place that there really isn't any shortcut are powders. With powders, you can get a powder, you can look at the burn rates, you can look in the load manuals and see that the charge weights are very similar, or what charge weight you need to get a similar pressure level. But in the end, I am still going to do a full load workup on those cases because powder just, that's your main charge. That is what is generating all the pressure. And just when I see people blow up guns, powder is usually what caused it. Either they're using a powder that they're unfamiliar with and screwed up their charge weights. Of course, there's always the getting pistol powder mixed in with your rifle powder. That will blow a gun up very quickly. So anytime that you are switching powders, first of all, make sure that you have completely cleared out your powder throw, any of your powder measures. Remove that powder from your workspace before you introduce a new powder into the workspace. And then if it's a powder that you've never worked with before, definitely do a load workup. Consult a load manual. And I'm going to tell you, if you can't find a published load from one of the load manuals for the powder that you're using in the cartridge that you intend to use it in, do not use it. Have hard data before you go out there and you try to do it. Unless you are a super advanced reloader and you are willing to take the risk of blowing your gun up, blowing your face up, etc., stick to published loads. There's a ton of information out there on the internet. Just make sure you verify it and it's not somebody moving a decimal in the wrong place or transposing numbers on powders and you take their word for it and then you end up blowing the gun up. So make sure you consult the load manual and use the correct powders for the correct cartridges. I know there's a lot of temptation out there if you have a ton of one powder, trying to make that powder work in another cartridge that you maybe don't have the correct powder for, But be very careful when you do that. There are some powders out there, like H4350, that will work for a really wide variety of cartridges. Vargant and Reloader 15 are also have a ton of cartridges that they work for. But there are some things that they really do not work for. When you get up into things like 300 Win Mag, the powders that I use for 223 and for 308 really are not suitable for that specific cartridge. So we have to be careful with that stuff. In the end, it's your gun and it's your face, but what you do can reflect poorly on the rest of us. So be very careful when you're doing that kind of stuff and you're experimenting and you're trying to make things work. But that's just a few tips to try to conserve components and to try to keep shooting in what we have going on here in this horrible market for reloaders at this time. Everybody keeps asking, okay, where are all the components? Well, you have to remember that the vast majority of shooters are buying loaded ammunition. So the components are going into loaded ammunition. There is not a lot of incentive for manufacturers right now just to produce components for reloaders when there is a higher markup on loaded ammunition. So I don't think we are going to see the reloading market come back to a really happy place until the loaded ammunition is back to a happy place. So I think we still have quite a few dark months ahead for reloaders. That's one of the reasons I've been shooting a lot of rimfire, because I can still buy match rimfire ammunition. Bulk rimfire has been hit or miss. But match rimfire is floating around out there if you look close enough. So biggest things I want you to get over this is don't just blindly swap components. On most things, drop down 10% and work back up to be as safe as you can. And finally, if you know where you can find a good deal on primers, send me an email. I'd appreciate it. So that's going to do it for this Mail Call Mondays. If you guys have any questions or comments over anything we've covered, please drop it in the comment section down below. And I want to hear, how are you dealing with the component shortage? What strategies are you using to try to get the components that you need to get? So please drop a tip down below. I'm sure everybody would like to read it. And if you guys want to learn how to support the content that you know and love, please check us out over on Patreon. And until next time, get out and shoot.